This is Shelley Kraft coming to you live on SNNLive. We're coming to you from the Sprott Natural Resource Symposium 2019 here in Vancouver. With me today is Paul Cronin from Adriatic Metals. It's a publicly traded company on the ASX, and the symbol is ADT. Paul, welcome to SNNLive.
G'day, Shelley. Thanks very much for having me.
Good to have you. Let's get started with an overview of the company and we'll go from there.
Yeah, sure. Adriatic Metals is a UK company but listed on the ASX. We have a high-grade polymetallic project in Bosnia. So that includes gold, silver, zinc, lead, copper, and barite.
Okay, let's get some history on the project and on the company.
Sure. Look, the company was incorporated in early 2017 specifically to buy this asset. We did some due diligence on the asset. We paid cash for it. We went in there in April 2017 and we started doing confirmation drilling. The assets were previously in production, but the outset of the war in Bosnia meant that they were shut down. They went through an elongated bankruptcy process and basically sat through a bankruptcy process for 20 years. When they came out the other side, we snapped them up. We went in there, put our first drill hole in April 2017, having completed the acquisition in March, and we hit 86 metres at 13% zinc in the old open pit. We continued to drill that out over the course of the next few months to confirm the resource, so we have a JORC resource on it. And we went up the hill to the other area where the Yugoslavs have been doing some exploration, and we saw some inklings of pretty high-grade thick mineralisation there from the old data that we acquired and digitised. But when we got in there with our first drill rig, we hit 63 metres at about 33% zinc. It was a monster drill hit. And then we thought, right, we're onto something here. So I said to our chief geologist, I'm not a geologist, I said, look, I want to step out 50 metres this way. And we hit nothing. Next, so he said, look, I'll decide where the holes go from now on. And we continued to drill north. And we hit 7 out of our 8 holes were very, very high-grade mineralisation. At that point, I'd run out of money, and I said, like, it's time to get some external money into this thing. We raised $1 million from a few institutions in Australia and Asia, and we set about listing the company. We listed it on the ASX on the 1st of May 2018. It was the best performing ASX company of 2018. Our share price has gone up to $1.25, so we listed at 20 cents, $1.25. All of our shareholders have made money. And we've only just put out our maiden resource on Rupitsa, which makes it a very large, very high-grade polymetallic deposit. So having done that, we're still doing more exploration. And over the course of 2019 and 2020, we're going to be drilling like crazy. We're finding opportunities to extend our known mineralisation into the north, to the west, to the south. We've got areas down the southern end of our licence where we know the Yugoslavs constructed serious adits that were capable of going into production, where we found the waste heaps, the rocks that they threw away, and they were over 40% zinc equivalent. So we know that this is a very, very prospective region, but we also know that we've got to try and get this on the production path pretty quickly. So we're now working on a scoping study, or in Canadian terms, a preliminary economic assessment, looking at the economics of the project. We've done the high-level trade-off studies in terms of do we build it as an open pit or an underground. I think we've now made a decision on that, which will come out in October when we release that study. We're doing all of the metallurgical work, the geotechnical work. We're advancing this thing as quickly as we can. But whilst we're doing all of that, we're continuing to push out and add more tonnes and more high-grade material, with the intent of trying to grow the project from its global resource now of about 16 million tonnes to about 30 million tonnes, you know, over the next 12 months.
So what's left of the original camp? Do you have, were they actually mining there, or is it old equipment? Or?
Yeah, they were mining there. There was a big Soviet-style concrete bunker-type flotation plant, which has been largely vandalised or damaged during the Bosnian War. The only building left on that site that was sort of semi-inhabitable was the old administration block. And when we went in there in March 2017 and started to clear it out to use it as a core shed and an exploration office, putting in windows and painting walls and whatever else, There was no stairs up into the upper levels of this building, and we climbed up there on an outside ladder. And scattered all over the floor, we found thousands of typed reports that detailed all of the exploration that had been done in Yugoslavia between 1960 and 1990. It was a treasure trove of information.
Like drill results, etc.
Drill hole logs, metallurgical work, geological reports detailing your reserves and resources that they'd defined all over the region that we weren't even aware of. So once we started going through all that information, digitizing what we could, looking at it on maps, georeferencing everything, we decided we needed to get more land. And so last October, we did a massive expansion of our concession areas. We had to write a huge check for it. In Bosnia, one of the reasons why there hasn't been a lot of junior exploration is that to buy a mineral concession requires you to pay about $1 million per square kilometre up front. Now, the royalties are pretty low. You're not paying at the back end like you'd expect anywhere else. You're paying up front. Now, junior explorers can't do that. But armed with all of this information, we can very selectively target the areas that we want, pay the fee, and then get in there and do the work. And that's what we're doing.
So it sounds friendly to me.
As an environment to operate, it's fantastic. You've got a highly skilled workforce, low labour costs, fantastic infrastructure, the lowest power prices in Europe. We've got a railway coming close to site that can take our concentrates or ores directly to port.
Logistics, you have your infrastructure.
It's absolutely perfect as an operating jurisdiction.
So, this silly question, what's your competitive advantage?
Well, I think the fact that we're actually a first mover in country gives us a lot of advantage. We've got a good team now. We've got a good rapport with government. We're sponsoring local football teams. You know, we're the second biggest employer in our local town now. We're continuing to do a lot of exploration and gather a lot of information about the geology of the region and how these high-grade deposits got there. And as we start to sort of unravel the puzzle, we're starting to realise that we're actually sitting on quite a prolific mineral belt.
So let's talk about these minerals, right? Because the base metals, and you know, there's demand coming for all of that in the new era of electric vehicles, etc. Yeah. So explain a little bit of that to me.
Yeah. So look, our base metals are copper, zinc, and lead. Lead's obviously used in batteries. Zinc is used in steel production. Copper is used in electrification. There's always going to be a strong demand for those metals. In addition to that, we've got gold and silver. Now, obviously, in a period where we are seeing, monetary and fiscal turbulence, gold and silver prices are doing well. But what we've also got, which is quite interesting, is a mineral called barite. So our barite grades are typically around 30%.
What is barite used in?
Yeah, it's an unknown mineral. Primarily, it's used in oil and gas drilling. So it acts as a densifying agent as a blowout preventer. Now, barite, the biggest consumption of barite, as you'd expect, is the Middle East and the US. Prices are very good at the moment, and if you can provide a good quality barite product, you can get paid a premium for it. We got heaps of the stuff. Our grades are very high when we produce the pure barite. Our specific gravity, the density of it, is very good.
From what you could tell me as a public company, what are some growth drivers for the rest of 2019 and 2020 coming?
Yeah, look, our biggest growth driver is going to be the scoping study. This is where we're going to show what the economics of a high-grade project of our size actually look like in a jurisdiction where costs are very, very low. Once we've done that, we're going to be making an application to the Bosnian government for exploitation. I think by the end of the year, we'll have that scoping study done, we'll have the exploitation permit in the bag, and all during that time, we're going to be continuing with exploration. We'll carry through exploration right through 2020, but we'll also put our feasibility study together in 2020 with the intent to be commencing construction early in 2021. So that's a lot happening in a short period of time.
What's your background, and tell us about some of your management team?
Yeah, so I first started working in Eastern Europe for Philip Morris, the cigarette company, straight out of university. Then went into commodity trading and into investment banking, specialising in the resources sector. I put together a team for Adriatic that was hand-picked. Peter Bilby's our chairman, chairman of Independence Group, one of Australia's largest mining companies. Milos Bosnakovic, he's a renowned Bosnian lawyer. We've got Michael Rawlinson, the former head of metals and mining for Barclays Bank in London. Julian Barnes, we've picked up a great operating team in Bob Annett, Graham Hill. So we've put an A-class team together.
Let's get your website out for more information for our investor audience, if you would.
It's www.adriaticmetals.com, and on there you'll find a new 3D image of the entire project, which is really interesting to look at.
Ladies and gentlemen, Paul Cronin, Adriatic Metals. It's ADT on the Australian Stock Exchange. I'm Shelley Kraft. This is SNN Live, coming to you live from the Sprott Natural Resource Symposium 2019 here in Vancouver. Paul, thanks so much for coming on.
Thanks, Shelley. Appreciate it.